Today I'm going to talk about whether oxalates are bad for you, so stay tuned. If you're new here, welcome. My name's Amanda Malacheski. I'm a certified functional nutrition health coach and a digestive and allergy detective. For tips and tricks on how to eat without triggering your digestive symptoms and how to resolve your digestive symptoms for good, please consider subscribing and be sure to click the bell to be notified when I post a new video every week. You may have heard that oxalates in food can cause certain kinds of symptoms, but are they truly bad for you? In today's video, I'm going to answer that question and I'm going to help you think about the answer for yourself. I use this way of thinking about any food or fad diet or any other health claim, and it might be able to help you make appropriate choices going forward in other situations too. So let's get started. So a lot of people are learning about the role that oxalates can play in certain kinds of symptoms. And when people come into my practice talking about pain symptoms, especially gut pain, back pain, joint pain, headaches, or migraines, and also maybe kidney stones, frequent kidney stones, I think about oxalates as a cause. But are they really bad? But as can easily happen with this kind of information is that the potential trigger, in this case oxalates, can become kind of vilified and people can kind of get into a panic about it, and a lot of people start removing these foods from their diet. The thinking goes, if oxalates are bad, maybe I should get rid of them, and then people start making drastic changes. But many high oxalate foods are actually perfectly healthy foods, and we don't necessarily want to avoid foods that are perfectly healthy, right? So are oxalates bad for you or not? To answer this question, we need a little bit more context. As a functional nutrition health coach, the question for me isn't, are oxalates bad? The question is, are oxalates bad for you? And to answer this question, we need to do a little bit more assessment to figure out the answer to this question. The main tool I use to help my clients do this assessment is a food symptom tool, and in this case, along with an oxalate food list. And if you came into my office as a client, I would also be looking at other potential contributing root causes to a potential oxalate problem. And you can hear more about that in my video, Oxalate Sensitivity Root Causes. So to tell if oxalates are involved with some of your symptoms, I recommend using the food symptom diary for about 5 to 7 days to track your food intake alongside of your symptoms, and to see if you can make any correlation or connection between what you're experiencing and what you're eating. And it's good to keep in mind here that sometimes food reactions can be delayed up to 3 to 4 days. So that's why the food symptom tracking tool is really important, because it's kind of difficult to remember what you ate 5 days ago. So as an example, using a food symptom diary, I was able to make a really clear connection between the fact that every time I ate almonds, I got extremely severe back pain, like back pain that laid me up for days at a time. And I also noticed a connection between chocolate and abdominal pain. If you don't see any correlations in the initial round of tracking, I encourage you not to get discouraged, because some of the connections are a little subtler and harder to see, but that's why we want to keep using the tool. So sometimes it could take even up to a month of tracking to begin to see the pattern. Like, it took me about that long to discover that there was a connection between my eating broccoli and constipation, because it wasn't really outwardly clear. If you'd like a little bit more support with using a food symptom diary, you can check out my earlier video, How to Use a Food Diary for IBS, and you can also grab my oxalate food list. There's a link for both of those below this video. It turns out that with few exceptions, no real food ingredients are bad for you. Foods can be bad for you right now. They may not be working for your body, but that doesn't mean that they're bad foods. It just means that they're not working for you right now. And I find this especially true with other food sensitivities like histamine and salicylates, things that kind of involve these huge lists of foods. They're healthy foods and we don't want to avoid them necessarily. We just want to make sure that we're not feeding the fire of inflammation and symptoms by what you're eating regularly. Can oxalates cause symptoms? Yes. Are they bad for you? No. Unless you have symptoms from eating them, there's not really any reason to avoid them. Usually I find that oxalate sensitivity is due to upstream causes and usually has a lot to do with the state of your gut health. But gut health can definitely be improved. So if you're having symptoms from eating oxalate foods, don't despair. There's a lot of ways you can think into the situation and create some solutions for yourself. If you are having symptoms from oxalate foods, there are definitely things that you can do to reduce those symptoms and even to resolve the situation fully. So I talk about these over in my earlier video called How to Reduce Oxalate Sensitivity. I'm happy to report that all of my gut work has helped me resolve some of my oxalate sensitivity, and I've been able to add back in some of my favorite high oxalate foods that I was reacting to. In fact, just last week, I was able to enjoy a chocolate treat that didn't cause any belly pain for me, and that is a huge win. I'm curious what your oxalate journey has been like. Tell me a little bit more about it in the comments. So I hope that this quick video has helped put the whole oxalate situation into perspective and has helped you feel empowered about how to figure out whether oxalates are a problem for you. Remember, we want to avoid eliminating lots of healthy foods if we can, and so we want to be really clear about what truly is causing a problem for us and start there. If you still got more questions about how to figure this stuff out for yourself, I've put together a roadmap to gut recovery, which compiles the things that I've seen work for people who are trying to find freedom from their digestive symptoms. It's an action guide that helps you get started right now with understanding what the root causes of your challenges are and what you can do about them. You can download your free copy by heading over to confluencenutrition.com/roadmap, and there's also a link for that below this video. Or if you're ready for some help customizing what you're already doing, I'm an expert at helping you create a customized, doable plan. So if you'd like to meet with me to find out what it's like to work together, you can head over to confluencenutrition.com/contact and schedule yourself a free 30-minute assessment session where we can talk about what that would look like. So get out there and start tracking your food and your symptoms together to assess whether oxalates really truly are a challenge for you personally. And I look forward to hearing your comments and questions below, and look forward to seeing you next time.